Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Are you glad to be here? Say amen.
Amen.
How about you all stand with us? And we're talking about Paul on the road to Damascus today. And we're going to sing about Open the Eyes of My Heart, Lord. For just a minute. Welcome to Big Hill Christian Church. If you are visiting with us for the first time this morning, thank you so much for being here and joining our family here. This is just a building we meet. We as the people are the church, and so we're thanking you for joining our family here. If you're joining us online on Facebook Live or YouTube later on, thank you for being here with us online at home. We hope that you will join us one day in person. If you are not able to at this time, we hope one day you will. We do practice communion here. We will be taking it after the message. Those are for the baptized believers in Lord Jesus Christ. If you've been immersed, we offer that communion for you. If you do not have a cup, one of the ushers or one of the deacons will bring you one if you need to raise your hand. Last week, I started a series called Songs from the Jukebox, and I got several submissions. I want to thank each and every one of you who submitted a song. But I did choose one in particular this week that kind of went along with the message, and I didn't even know it until I got to hearing the story of this young lady and how it fits right along with Brother Jim's message this week. These songs that we sing are not just songs that we sing. They have a meaning to some of us. And I want you to watch this video here about our song from the jukebox this week.
When I was a teenager, I was diagnosed with keratoconus. It's where your cornea changes shape and deteriorates over time. In 2020, I had a corneal transplant. When I found out that the corneal transplant was my only option, God spoke through the song, "Do It Again." I listened to that song so much. My child was like, "Mom, please find a different song." But that song gave me confidence and comfort in what was coming ahead. I even played it when I went to the doctor, and it was actually played the Sunday before my surgery. So that was, you know, God speaking to me again. And I remember being on my way to the operating room and the nurse telling me, you know, I was going to be okay. And I told her I wasn't worried about it, that God had this, He had spoken over it. And they ran tests once, and the doctor didn't believe that the nurse had done it correctly, redid all the tests, and said the results were so good, they were not medically explainable. The answer is simple. It's God. He is the great physician, and He can move them. My last appointment, they said with new contacts, I'll be seeing better than they ever even thought possible. So when God speaks, fear can be gone.
Would you stand with us as we sing "Do It Again" this morning?
Still in your hands, this seen you move. You move the mountains, and I believe I'll see you do it again. You made a way where there was no way, and I believe I'll see you do it again. I've seen you move. You move the mountains.
Remain standing, you have that option as well. We're going to sing about the goodness of God. And Paul, when he was on his road to Damascus, when he was stopped by God, he thought he was doing God's work, but he found out otherwise. And you know, Jesus, God could have cast him, you know, aside, but he doesn't do that because God is good. And Paul really found out on his road to Damascus about the goodness of God.
Goodness of God.
Y'all can be seated.
Good morning, church. It's good to see everybody here this morning. If you will, take your Bibles, go with me to Acts chapter 9 and hold that ready. You know, last week we started by talking about what a rotten character Saul of Tarsus was. How he believed that he was doing God's will, but he truly wasn't. And we have a hard time seeing that because we have a tendency to look at the Apostle Paul. Let's take the Apostle's words about the Pharisee Saul. So if you will, keep your thumb there in Acts 9, but go to the right over to Acts chapter 26. And let's see what Paul the Apostle says about Saul the persecutor. In Acts chapter 26, verse 10 and 11, Paul writes these words. And this is just what I did in Jerusalem. Not only did I lock up many of the saints in prisons, having received authority from the chief priest, but also, when they were put to death, I cast my vote against them. And as I punished them often in all the synagogues, I tried to force them to blaspheme. And being furiously enraged at them, I kept pursuing them, even to foreign cities. Pray with me. Father, this morning, as we take a look at conversion, we look at the Damascus Road experience where Saul of Tarsus came face to face with Jesus Christ. And Lord, while we look to this encounter, we often say, I wish that I could have that kind of an experience, that kind of a conversion in my life. So, Lord, as we look to your word, I pray that those of us who are believers can look back to the time we weren't, just as we've done here with Paul the Apostle looking back to Saul the Pharisee and realizing, I am no longer that person. Because I have come to Jesus Christ, I am a new creation in him. Father, I pray that we leave here this morning, new creations in you. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So we know that Saul, according to Paul, says that he was a persecutor of the church. He was going after them, and as he had mentioned here, he said he went as far as to go even to foreign cities to find them. The historian Josephus writes that at the time of the persecution of the church, when they would exile from Jerusalem and scatter abroad among the countryside and all over, he says that there could have possibly been as many as 10,000 Christian exiles that had gone to Damascus. Saul must have gotten word of this, and that's where he was headed. In Acts chapter 9, the first two verses, we see that he was given a commission by the authorities to go to Damascus, take prisoner of all of the Christians that he could, and bring them back to stand trial. And in chapter 9, verse 1, it says, Paul still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord. He was passionate. He wanted to go all that way. And if you consider the fact that there could have been as many as 10,000 Christians in the Damascus area, what kind of task force do you think he was taking with him? It wasn't just Saul and a handful of guys. He must have had an army with him. And it says that he took this trek, and I went to the back of my study Bible, and I got my ruler out, and looked at the maps, and if you look at Jerusalem to Damascus, it looks like it's about 150 miles. Paul says later in Scripture it was a 6-mile trip, or 6-day trip. So I want you to picture, like I try to get us to do often, I want you to put yourself in the place of one of these soldiers going with Saul on a 6-day journey, 150 miles, to capture those who were called of the way of Jesus Christ. What do you think Saul was thinking each day as he led this group of soldiers? Just my thoughts. He probably was thinking what a great thing he was doing for the church. These folks were heretics. They were apostates. They had left the church. They were following a whole new religion altogether. They weren't keeping the law. They were talking now about grace and mercy and forgiveness and eternal life and not being convicted by the law and following the Pharisees and the priests and all who were leading them in what they believed to be the true way. So Saul was probably pretty upset. Like I said, he's breathing threats of murder. And he may have been thinking about some of the previous trips he had been on to where he had captured prisoners. He had taken Christians and brought them back in the hell trial. And as he was talking about in Acts 26, where he would sign off on their executions. He would put them into prison. He was doing the things that should be done because it's the right thing to do. That's the way he thought. But I wonder, as he was thinking about those, if he could remember individual accounts. Maybe he thought of Stephen, one of the 7 chosen deacons to begin with. And it says how great things had been done that he had done. He was astounding people with his knowledge and his love and his devotion to the Lord. And people were coming to the Lord because of Stephen's encounters with them. And how that upset the Pharisees. And how they had taken Stephen and brought false charges against him. And they became so enraged at the fact that they couldn't seem to get to him that they drug him out of the city and they stoned him to death. And while they were doing so, Paul stood there with the cloaks and the coats of those who were doing the stoning, giving hearty approval to Stephen's death. And according to the account, in the encounter, Saul very well could have heard Stephen praying, "Lord, receive my spirit. Father, don't hold this sin against them." And it said in the Scripture that his face shone like an angel. I wonder if that face stayed in Saul's mind. And he wondered, how could someone be so devoted, so committed, that they would take this without showing any pain or suffering or sorrow? Even to the point to where they would ask forgiveness for the ones who were persecuting and killing him. Perhaps he thought about Gamaliel, how we read in Acts 5, how they were plotting against Peter and the apostles because they had been teaching. They wanted to kill them as well. But Gamaliel, the very one who had trained Saul from childhood up to the ranks where he was now, stood up and on behalf of Peter and the apostles, he told them, "Look, this has happened before. There have been other leaders who have come and led these revolts, if you will, but they all went away. This probably will be the same thing that happens to these guys, but if it isn't, it's of God. And if it's of God, who are we to stand in the way?" And I wonder what Saul was thinking about those words that Gamaliel had spoken. But he kept going closer, closer, and closer, day by day, getting to Damascus. And where we're going to pick it up this morning, what I'd like for you to consider, if it truly was 150 miles, on the 6th day, probably 149 and a half miles into his mission, as they're coming close to the city, you can almost hear one of the soldiers say, "Look, there's Damascus." As soon as that happens, at high noon, we're told, everything changed for Saul, the Pharisee. So if you will, take your Bibles, go with me to chapter 9. Let's look at verse 3, and I want to read verses 3 down through 9 And then I've got some challenges. I want us to think about some things. So Acts chapter 9, verse 3. As he was traveling, it happened that he was approaching Damascus, and suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him, and he fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" And he said, "Who are you, Lord?" And he said, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But get up and enter the city, and it'll be told you what you must do." The men who traveled with him stood speechless, hearing the voice, but seeing no one. Saul got up from the ground, and though his eyes were open, he could see nothing. And leading him by the hand, they brought him into Damascus. And he was there 3 days without sight, and neither ate nor drank. Picture us with Saul again. There's the city. As soon as we see it, there's like a flash of lightning, but it's not lightning. It's so bright, it knocks us all to the ground. And we're waiting for the thunder. But the thunder doesn't come. Instead, we hear the voice of Christ himself. "Saul, why are you persecuting me?" All the thinking, all the scheming, all the anger and the hatred that was in Saul day by day by day, coming closer and closer to Damascus. Now he realizes what's taking place. All of these people of the way, the apostates, those heretics, those people that were so consumed with a dead carpenter, all of a sudden he hears the voice of Jesus asking, "Why are you persecuting me?" And something that just, to me, just stands out. Why didn't he answer the question? When Jesus asks, "Why are you persecuting me?" Saul responds with, "Who are you, Lord?" Do you think he really didn't know who was talking to him? When the voice said, "Why are you persecuting me?" Saul knew who he was persecuting. Saul knew he was passionate about getting rid of. Saul knew what his mission was and who he was after. He knew the answer to the question. But the Lord asked him the question so he could come face to face with the reality of where he was. As a matter of fact, if you will, go back to Acts 26 again. And I want to read verse 14 to you. There's something recorded here that isn't in the other account that I think is very important. In verse 14, chapter 26, it says, Paul speaking, "And when we had fallen to the ground, I heard a voice saying to me in the Hebrew dialect, 'Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? It is hard for you to kick against the goads.'" Everybody know what a goad is? Anybody know what a goad is? It's a Greek word. And the word is kintron. And what it is, what we would compare it to today, is a cattle prod that's not electric. It was a long stick with a sharp point on one end of it. And shepherds and cattlemen would use those to slap at the animals to keep them in line, to keep them on path, to keep them from straying. And Jesus here is telling Saul, it's hard for you to kick against the goads. It's hard for you to not hear me, to not obey me. You keep kicking against me, but I keep guiding and directing. You see, Saul thought, as the persecutor, he was going to track down the Christians and bring them back to stand trial. He didn't realize he was being tracked too. And at just the right time, the sky opens, the light comes, Saul is knocked to his knees along with the other men with him, and Jesus asks him, "Why are you persecuting me?" And even at that point, Saul didn't want to believe who he was encountering. He said, "Who are you, Lord?" And if one of the commentaries that I used said that this was not necessarily him acknowledging Christ as Christ, this was him acknowledging someone higher than he is, more superior, more authoritative than he is, someone he needed to answer to. Perhaps he was hoping, hope against hope, that this could be somebody else, and he wasn't coming face to face with the reality. His belief system was wrong. And you may say, well, Jim, you're kind of fishing here. Well, what about us? How do we respond? How do we kick against the goads? How often are we knocked back in line by the Holy Spirit, prodded, directed, maybe a gentle tap here or there, maybe just a full swing at us to try to get us back into where we should be in the relationship we're called to have with the Lord? You ever been brought back into line? And you hope it's something else? You don't want it to be the Lord convicting your heart that you are off track, that you are wrong, that you may be sincere in your beliefs, but you're sincerely wrong in what you're doing? It's hard to kick against the goads because culture tells us to live for yourself. God's word says, die to yourself. And in this encounter, what happens right here with Saul of Tarsus? When the light came, when he was knocked to his knees, when the Lord said, why are you persecuting me? It's hard for you to kick against the goads. Saul came to the end of Saul of Tarsus. The persecutor, the proud, the powerful, the in charge Pharisee that was going to go take Damascus, now suddenly was the prisoner. He was the one that had to be led by hand into the city, into Judas's house on Straight Street. And for 3 days, he was blind. He couldn't eat. He couldn't drink. You think? What would we be like? What would it be like to be on the top of the food chain and now everything you had lived for, everything you had accomplished, all that you were was wrong, a lie. And for 3 days, just like Jonah, for 3 days, he had time to think. He couldn't see anymore physically, but I bet his spiritual eyes were opened. The only thing he could focus on, I imagine, is the words of Jesus where he said, go into town. And it will be told what you must do. What do you think those words would mean to you if you were Saul in his situation? Perhaps, as the persecutor, Saul was taking people and putting them into prison, and he'd say, you stay there, and we'll come back and deal with you later. And we know what that meant. Imprisonment, stoning, execution. Perhaps he was thinking the same thing from the other side of the bars now. He could be well thinking, I've got 3 days of life left. Because that's what he was used to. That's the way it worked for him. If you were wrong, you paid for that mistake with your life. And so he was wrong. So this is what was due him. This is what he had earned. Again, what about us? What about when we come face to face with the Lord? And we have time to think about where we truly are in our relationship and what it means and how we've been wrong and how we've sinned and how we're separated from the Lord. And now we have this encounter with the Lord and we have all of that not just be something we dance around or talk in theory about in Bible studies or Sunday school classes or small group studies. This is face-to-face reality with the Lord Himself saying, "Why are you against me?" Do we see that? Is this just something that happened to Saul of Tarsus long ago? Or maybe this could have been something that happened to us this week. My prayer is that it opens to us here now. But as he looks at this, as he's in this situation, and he has 3 days to consider all that needs to be fixed, how would we cope? You see, we say, I heard last week, I said that I've heard some of us here, when we talk about the Damascus Road, say, "Boy, I wish I could have that kind of an experience. I wish that the Lord could just speak to my heart. I'm walking along life, doing life the way I always do, and all of a sudden, boom, I come face to face with Jesus Christ, and He changes my life, and I become like Paul the Apostle, and I'm just a super Christian." Well, that conversion process involves what we're talking about here, right now. Coming face to face with our inadequacy, with our disobedience, with our disregard for who Jesus is and who He calls us to be, to choose us as our God rather than the true God as God, and to live that kind of life, to realize that my belief system's wrong. He's asking me the same question: why are you not following me? And we justify it with all kinds of excuses and justification. But family, the bottom line is, when Christ comes into our life and asks us to follow Him, when we don't, what we're saying is, "I don't want to." You can sugarcoat it. You can justify it. But that's what it is. I want to share a quote from Oswald Chambers. He's talking about the rich young ruler. Do you remember? You remember that encounter where the young man came to Jesus and said, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" And He says, "Keep the commandments." Remember what he said? "I've done that from the beginning. I'm good. All of those commandments, I keep them. There's nothing against me." That was the gimme question. Jesus follows it up with this: if you want to be a disciple, if you want to be fully committed, go sell everything you have and then come back and follow me. You remember his response? Couldn't do it. The world was more important than the Lord. His social standing, his comfort, his self was more important than what he was asking the Lord to give him. He couldn't do it. And Oswald Chambers says this. He says, "Our Lord never pleaded. He never cajoled. He never entrapped. He simply spoke the sternest words mortal ears ever listened to, and then he left it alone." We read God's word. We hear his voice. The goads of the Holy Spirit are constantly hitting at us, driving us closer to him, calling us back to get on the path that we've been called to walk. And we constantly fight against it. Here, Chambers tells us that the Lord will ask. He'll show you your sin. He'll show you the relationship he wants to have with you. He'll call you to obedience, but he stops. The decision is yours. How we respond falls on us. It's not on anything else. For 3 days, Saul of Tarsus dealt with that. Why are you persecuting me? Just as he calls us today, why are you not mine? Why are you not accepting my gifts of forgiveness, mercy, grace, salvation, fellowship, encouragement, peace, joy, abundant life? Why are you turning all of those things down? And he stops. We must answer. And how we do determines our eternal future. So I've got five points I want to make here. Saul of Tarsus, the Pharisee of Pharisees, he called himself at one time. He believed that his intellect, that his knowledge, that his study of the law was the best way to heaven. And then one of the commentaries I use says, the soul is in danger when knowledge of doctrine outsteps the intimate touch of Jesus Christ. Family, you can know the Bible forward, backward, inside and out, memorized in three different languages. But if you have not encountered Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you don't have the love of Christ in your heart, it's nothing. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, known as the love chapter, if I have all of these things, but I don't have the love of Christ in my life, it's nothing. He also said later on, he said, all of these things that I've accumulated, all of the boasting, all of the bragging, all the accolades, all of the position, all of the awards, all of the things that I have, it's rubbish compared to knowing Jesus Christ. Can you say that? Can we make that statement that there is nothing more important than our relationship with the Lord? It's also said that a new life truly begins with a divine encounter with Jesus Christ. You see, we don't look at it this way, I think. But in the truest sense, when Christ knocked Saul to his knees, he was offering him salvation. We tend to see him as stopping what was going on. But look at what he was offering to Saul. And what we see often as thou shalt not kind of commandments, or the difficulties that we go through, or the challenges that we face in life where we think God's stopping our lives, he in the truest sense is calling us to him. When we face difficulties, it says you are facing tribulation. Take heart. Well, how can we take heart? Saul here, I'm sure, here he doesn't see it, but he writes about it from then on, how the Lord came into his life and changed everything. He bragged about who he used to be, and in the same breath he said, it's all nothing. Now I can see that past life led me to the encounter that I had with the Lord who changed my life forever. What about our lives? You see, I don't think we've truly converted unless we have truly come to Christ. We want to say we have. We want to say that, yeah, I came forward and I confessed my sins and I was baptized and now I'm good to go. We can do every one of those things and never come to Christ. It's your heart. It's the calling that he places on you. It's the conviction. It's the goads that we've been given to come to Christ. Not to come to a church. To come to a relationship with the Lord that brings you into the church, the family. We think what we do is join a church and Christ comes along for the ride. No. We come to Christ and he places us as individual members of the body of Christ to work, to worship, and to glorify him. And to go into the world with the gospel and become his disciples. Thirdly, it said the Lord prepares us for that encounter with goats. Do we? Do you see God working in your life? Do you fight impulses? Do you get mad about situations that come along in our life where we know we should do this, it's the right thing to do, but daggone it, it just doesn't fit right now. I don't want to. I'm too mad at them. I can't love them. Give me some time and I'll get over it. Or you know, God's working on my heart, but, you know, going to take a while. Well, who's setting the time frame? Who's deciding when God's going to work in our lives? He's asking. He's pleading. Why are you not obeying me? Why are you not loving them? Why are you not obeying my commandments? I don't want to. Fourth, he's gracious, full of grace. You know, we play this game a lot. We don't like to talk about it because it seems irreverent. But if you were God, what would you do with Saul? He's killed numerous Christians. He's imprisoned a lot of his people. He's passionately going out to persecute the church. What would we do about that? We say, well, I would forgive him and I would work with him. Then why can't we work with our neighbor? Why are we upset with our boss? Why do we argue with our wives? Why are we always on our kids? There's grace involved, isn't there? We want other people to get the judgment that's due them, but I want grace. I want mercy because I'm special. That's what we think. God was being gracious to Saul because God had plans for Saul, just like he does for each and every one of us, if we will come to that encounter, that Damascus Road experience in our lives. And finally, he has a plan for every life that we can discover, but first we must encounter Christ. I want you to think about this. Are we living our lives the way we want to because we're good Christian people and that's what Christian people are supposed to do? Or have we become broken, knocked down to our knees, blinded by the world around us, by what the Lord is offering to us to see that God has a plan for our lives? Saul, I'm sure, thought he was living out his life's dream, persecuting the church. But the Lord had other plans for him. Have you given your life to the Lord and submitted to his plans for your life? Are we being Saul? Or could we possibly become a Paul? Have you truly encountered Jesus Christ? Or have we just said we have? Have we fooled ourselves into thinking that the Lord has really come into my life? The Holy Spirit is working on me. I have died to myself. I'm taking up my cross every day, and I'm following the Lord in full obedience to what he has for me, just like Paul the Apostle. Or have we made up our own belief system and we're following it just like Saul of Tarsus? My prayer this week for each and every one of us, and I've been trying to remember all your faces while I'm looking around, is that we come to the Lord and we are blinded, that we are knocked flat on our face, and we spend 3 days on Straight Street in isolation, not able to see the world around us, but only to hear the words of Jesus Christ, "Why are you not mine?" And we answer him. We know what we're entitled to. We know what we've earned. We know what we deserve. But he's offering mercy and grace, forgiveness, direction, the Holy Spirit to come and live inside of us, to lead us and guide us in all things. That's my prayer for us. And I pray it's so strong, just like with Saul, that we can't think of nothing else but the conviction that the Holy Spirit puts on us, the goads that we're being hit with. It's hard to kick against them because God's a sovereign God. He'll never leave us. He'll never forsake us. He disciplines those that he loves. And family, he's calling us to him now. So as we sing our invitational hymn, I want you to bow your heads. I want you to pray. I want you to ask the Lord to come into your heart and show you whatever it is that he's goading you with right now. And that we realize, just as he tells us in Scripture, if we will confess our sins, he's faithful, he's just, he'll forgive us our sins. He'll take us from Saul and end us and give us a new life, a new creation in him. And next week, we're going to talk about Paul. What about Paul? Saul's gone. Paul, a new creation in Christ, and where he took off. Pray with me. Father, as we come to you this morning, as we come to a time of invitation, Lord, it's my prayer that we hear you calling to us. And Father, if that means to come forward for prayer, so be it. If that means that we drop to our knees and seek your forgiveness, so be it. Father, if we've played around with being fully committed to you, and we see the need to give our lives completely to you in full obedience in baptism, Lord, help us to realize everything's here. But Lord, I pray we hear you calling to us. Why are you not mine? Lord, help that to pierce our hearts. And help us, Lord, to not be able to get away from it till we come face to face with you. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Would you stand with us as we sing our invitation? morning we come to our communion time. It's a time we partake of a meal together as a family. The Bible commands that we meet around the table each week to observe the Lord's Supper. That's what the early church did. That's what we do here. And this morning I want to talk a little bit about Paul. Brother Jim has mentioned, you know, all the, you know, rough things that Paul did and how, you know, Paul's life was. And he realized that, as he pointed out in Acts chapter 26, he realized how he was. And so I went to the book of 2 Corinthians, and he was writing to the Corinthian church, and he says this. He says, "But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, so that the surpassing greatness of the power will be of God and not from ourselves. We are afflicted in every way, but not crushed, perplexed, but not despairing, persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed, always carrying about in the body the dying of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our body. For we who are live are constantly being delivered over to death for Jesus' sake, so that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our mortal flesh." Jesus died for us. Every day we live our lives, we go about and we have that thought in our mind, the death of Jesus. Our bodies, physical bodies, are dying every day. We get older, but our spiritual bodies have life, and we have it more abundantly, as the Bible says. And so as we partake of this meal together, think about yourself this week. The Bible says to examine yourself. That's what Paul told the Corinthians, 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Examine yourself and see if there's something that you've done this week that maybe you need to draw closer to God and be better than you were this past week. Let's pray. Our Father God in heaven, Father, we're so grateful and humble we can come to you as our Lord and our Master and our Savior. We pray for this bread, which represents your body, and the cup, which represents your shed blood. I pray, Father, we do not take this in an unworthy manner. And God, I pray that we examine ourselves, that we figure out what is it that I've done this past week that I could do better for the cause of Christ. Paul, he went 3 days on Straight Street. And I pray that this week, Father, we do that as Brother Jim has challenged us. What can we do better that we have not been doing? Thank you, God, for all your blessings. In Jesus' name, amen.
I want to thank you all for being with us today. Just to our visitors, pray that you'll come back. And to the rest of us, I have a couple of announcements I'd like to go over with briefly, very quickly. I hope that you all have a copy of the sermon outline, and on the back are the announcements. So I don't want to go over those, but just want to touch on a couple things that are coming up quickly. This evening, or this afternoon, 4 o'clock, we're going to have our official church board meeting. All the members of the church are invited and urged to come. We'd love to have your input and know how you feel about some of the things that we're working on now as a church. 6 o'clock, we're having our discipleship studies. We're going to be talking about the faithfulness of God's promises. How do we convey that to other people as disciples? How do we share that with folks? Then Wednesday is family night. Obviously, we have our meal and classes for everybody. We'd like for you to be a part of that. And then the last thing I want to touch on that we have here is our deacon training sessions. In the Tuesdays in September, we're going to be holding deacon training sessions. Now, these are for all of the deacons that are constantly in the church and for any man who would like to know more about the office of deacon in the church. We're probably going to be meeting down in the basement, and would love to have all the men of the church that feel God's calling, maybe those goads again, to where we have the opportunity to serve the Lord. We feel He's calling to us. It's a great opportunity for us to meet each other and to ask to see what God is calling us to do. Also, next Saturday, this coming Saturday, big day for the guys and all of us, we're going to have our men's golf scramble. The 8 o'clock at South Wind Golf Course in Winchester. You can still sign up if you'd like. And then that afternoon, we're going to go to a Legends ball game. It's Faith and Family Night. And there's, I think, 32 of us have planned to go to that. And what I'm asking, if you signed up to go, if it's possible, we'd like for you to give us your money ahead of time. You can give it to me or to Brenda Bryan, our financial secretary, or if you want to write a check, just note it as Legends ball game and put it in the offering boxes, and we can do that. The kitchen crew would like to thank you for your donations and all that's been given to them. And if you would still like to give more, the QR code is on the table out there. They can show you what all they've received already, and they're grateful. But there's still some needs that we have. And then lastly, Jackie has a sign-up sheet out in the lobby. We're still working on our Kentucky Flood Relief Program. If you would like to be a part of that, maybe go down and help. There's a sign-up sheet for you to put your name, the ability, the talent that you have that you'd be able to use, and what days you'd be available. So, all that being said, yes, there's more.
Greg mentioned to me earlier that if there are some things that they had that were not on the QR code, he will be out there after service. If anybody wants to see that, he can sign them up. And if there are some things that weren't on the Amazon list that they still were looking for, so Greg.
Okay. Yeah, if you'd like to give and there's not things on the Amazon list, talk to Greg out there and he'd be glad to work with you. Okay? So, you have no excuse not to do something. We've got stuff going on all over the place, and we would love for you to take part in this. Remember about a year or so ago, we wish we had something we could do together? It's a blessing, folks. Let's get to work. If you will, please stand, and that's how word of prayer will be dismissed. Pray with me. Father God, it's truly great to be in your house, to be with like believers, those of us who have come to know you as our Lord and Savior, to come here together, as you tell us in Scripture, to lift one another up, to pray, to encourage, to strengthen each other. And Lord, as we look to the life of Saul of Tarsus, how today, where we're reading, it ended here. We know, Lord, that he became Paul, the apostle, and served you with his life. And Lord, I pray, just as that takes place that we know in Scripture happened, Lord, we ask that you give us 3 days on Straight Street this week. Father, speak to our hearts. Help us to realize the love that you have for us and the love that we have for each other that comes from you. And Lord, there's a world out there that desperately needs it. So, Father, as we always pray, lead us, guide us, direct us. As our kids sing in Sunday school, Lord, let our little light shine. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thanks for being with us.
So blind. sin was before me.